Welcome to the Hindu News Analysis by Shankar IAS Academy for the date, 19th of December 2019. Displayed are the list of news articles taken up for today's analysis, along with the page numbers of Chennai, Bengaluru, Delhi, Trivandrum and Hyderabad editions. The handwritten notes in PDF format and the timestamping of all the news articles taken up for today's analysis is available in the description section and also in the comment section for the benefit of the smartphone users. Let us now move on to our analysis session. This discussion is based on an editorial and also a data point which is related to the implementation of the Right to Information Act of 2005. See, this editorial discusses about certain problems and issues surrounding the proper implementation of this RTI Act, and this data point has some statistics related to the implementation of this RTI Act. So we shall be seeing both these together. The syllabus that can be linked to the discussion of both these news articles is given you for your reference. Now, before entering into the editorial discussion, let us first discuss about RTI Act in brief, which many of you might know. See, this Right to Information Act of 2005 was enacted to provide the right to information for the citizens. So, any individual can access the information which is under the control of public authorities. This right to information is enabled to promote transparency and accountability in the working of every public authority. To know in detail about this RTI Act, we request you to have a look at our 12th October the Hindu News Analysis video to have further subject clarity. Now, for the sake of today's discussion, we'll just see what we mean by public authority, which is defined in Section 2H of RTI Act 2005. So, as per this section, public authority means any authority or body or institution of self-government which is established or constituted by the Constitution or under the Constitution, or which is established or constituted by any other law that has been made by the Parliament or by any other law that has been made by the state legislatures, or which has been established or constituted by a notification that has been issued or by an order that has been made by the appropriate government, which can be the center or the state government. And if you see, public authority also includes any body that is owned, controlled or substantially financed either directly or indirectly by funds provided by the appropriate government. And public authority also includes non-government organizations that are substantially financed either directly or indirectly by the funds that are provided by the appropriate government. So any of these authority or body or institution is called as a public authority under the provisions of this RTI Act 2005. Now, let us see the editorial. We shall also be seeing about the data that has been given in the data point along with certain comments given by the author in this editorial. See, the author of this editorial has started this editorial by telling that the RTI Act is performing its role, which is to provide information to the citizens and also to make the government accountable. But there are still certain problems with respect to the implementation of this act. So it's mentioned certain problems in the editorial. So let us see them now. Now, one criticism which has been given by the author with respect to this RTI Act is based on a recent statement that has been given by the Chief Justice of India on this RTI Act. The Chief Justice of India noted that there is a misuse of this RTI Act, and this has created a sense of paralysis and fear in the government. Because of this, the officials are afraid of taking decisions. The Chief Justice of India has also said that the kind of queries that were sometimes being asked were not always in public spirit, and the queries were posed by people who had no locus standi in the matter regarding the queries. Here, you need to know this term, locus standi. It means the right or the ability to bring a legal action to a court of law or to appear in a court. So, by this comment, the Chief Justice of India means that the people who ask the queries have no ability to appear in the court regarding the same matter because they will not be able to justify the grounds on which they are seeking the information. Now, based on this statement, the author of this editorial notes that the argument by the Chief Justice of India is difficult to accept. Now, the author is telling this because he quotes certain provisions of the RTI Act which explicitly rejects the need for locus standi. It is the provisions that are given in Section 6.2 of this Act. This provision is related to request for obtaining information. This section clearly mentions that an applicant making a request for information shall not be required to give any reason for requesting the information or any other personal details except those that may be necessary for contacting the applicant. So you can see that the applicant shall not be required to give any reason. From this, we can tell that the statement made by the Chief Justice of India on the need for locus standi is contradicting the provisions of the RTI Act. Based on this, the author notes the reason for this particular clause, which does not demand locus standi. If this particular clause was not present, and if there is a need to establish locus standi, then the public authorities could choose to deny information to general citizens on subjective grounds, saying that the reason was not based on public spirit. Further, if you see, it will provide grounds for the information commissioners and the public officials to reject requests stating that there was no locus standi. Now, in this context, let us see certain conditions and situations based on which the RTI applications can be rejected. Currently, if you see under this RTI Act 2005, the rejection of application can be done by citing exemption under Section 8(1) of this RTI Act or by citing exemption under Section 9 of this Act. Now, if you see, Section 8 deals with exemption from disclosure of information and Section 9 deals with grounds for rejection to access in certain cases. Both these provisions provide certain conditions and cases for which the information need not be disclosed or the application can be rejected. Other than this, the information can be denied if the application fee was not paid, then if what has been sought in the application is not the information. Then if the RTI Act does not apply to a particular organization, or if the organization from whom the information is sought is actually not a public authority, etc. Now, if this locus standi is made compulsory, then it will provide an additional reason for the officials along with these reasons to deny or reject an application. It is because this creates another criterion for an exemption from disclosing the information. So, the information commissioners and the public officials can easily say that there was no locus standi and hence they reject the application. So, these are some of the certain conditions and situations based on which the RTI applications can be rejected. Now, this is important because more than not providing information, rejecting the application is common among the officials if you see. Only in the last year, the rejection percentage has come down. This inference is made by the Central Information Commission on its annual report. And this data is also given in the data point. As you can see here, the data on RTI requests since 2005 show that the yearly rejection rate has come down steadily to 4.7% in 2018-19. The Central Information Commission even noted this in this context that this is the lowest rejection percentage observed with respect to rejections under RTI Act since the inception of this commission. So now, the author is worrying that if the Act is to seek locus standi as a criterion to provide information, then again the rejection rate will dramatically increase. So this is one of the misgiving or the worrying fact or the problem which is surrounding this RTI Act. Then if you see, the next worrying fact is that even though Section 4 of this Act calls for proactive and voluntary dissemination of information by the public authorities, still, only a few central and state institutions have published relevant information proactively and voluntarily. According to the author, even a transparency audit report submitted to the Central Information Commission has confirmed this fact. If you see, in November 2018, this audit sought feedback from public authorities to evaluate the implementation of Section 4 of this Act. More than 35% of the public authorities turned out poorly with little transparency in parameters such as organization and functions, budget and program, e-governance, and other information disclosures. So this shows that there is a lack of proactive and voluntary dissemination of information by the public authorities. Now, to solve this problem, the author provides a solution. The public authorities can be advised to provide greater voluntary dissemination on government portals. So this will help to actually ease their load, which is created by the RTI applications. So, if information is already given, then people will not file an RTI application for the same. Now, a good example for this could be the Rajasthan government. See, the Rajasthan government has taken a lead in this matter through its Jan Suchna portal. Here, Jan Suchna means public information. So, it is a public information portal. This Jan Suchna portal 2019 is an initiative by the Department of Information Technology and Communication of the State Government of Rajasthan. It has been developed to provide information to the people. So it is first of its kind in which the information about all the schemes that are implemented by the government in the ward or panchayat are being provided at one place. So this portal has actually implemented the Section 4(2) of this Right to Information Act of 2005. This particular provision demands all public authorities to publish the information mentioned in the clause, such as particulars about the organization, functions, duties, etc. And these are to be published within 120 days from the enactment of this act based on this provision. So, the Rajasthan government has finally acted upon the provision, while still some other states have not yet done this. So, the author is recommending all the states to implement something like Jan Suchna portal in their respective states. Based on this only, the author named this editorial as a duty to publish. So, this is one problem. Now, if you see the next problem, the author has mentioned regarding the persisting vacancies in the state and central information commissions. Based on this problem, recently the Supreme Court has asked the center and states to expedite the filling up of these vacancies. Now, since the Supreme Court has intervened, we can hope that this problem will be solved in the near future. So, these are some of the problems which the author has discussed with respect to the poor implementation of RTI Act in this editorial. So, as a conclusion, we can say that only if such lacunae or problem are solved, the citizens can really exercise their right to information. So, to summarize this editorial, we saw in brief about this RTI Act, then about what is meant by a public authority as per the provisions of this RTI Act 2005. Then we discussed about certain issues or lacuna surrounding the implementation of this RTI Act, which the author has discussed in this editorial. Along with this, we also saw some data from the data point, which we have related to the comments given by the author in this editorial. Let us move on to the next news article. This news article is about the recent decision by the Union Ministry of Environment, Forests and Climate Change on the Kalasa Banduri project on Mahadai River. So, in this context, let us discuss in brief about the Mahadai River and then about the dispute that is associated with this river. The syllabus that is relevant to the analysis of this news article is given here for your reference. First, let us discuss about the Mahadai River. See, this river is known by different names. It is called the Mandovi River. It is pronounced as Mahadai River, then Mahadai. So, just know that it is called as Mahadai River or Mandovi River. See, this river originates in the Western Ghats in the Belagavi district of Karnataka. Then it flows westwards and it enters the state of Goa. And finally, it drains into the Arabian Sea. So, we can tell this river is a westward flowing river. Some of the other major westward flowing rivers in India are River Sabarmati, then River Narmada, River Tapi, then River Pamba, River Bharatapura, and some other minor rivers. Now, if you see, the famous Dudhsagar Falls is located in this river. If at all you get a chance, catch a train from Belgaum to Goa, especially during the monsoons, you'll be able to see this Dudhsagar Falls. Literally, it will flow like milk. Now, let's come back to the topic. The catchment area of this Mandovi River is spread among three states, which are the states of Goa, Karnataka and Maharashtra. Hence, the sharing of waters of Mandovi River is a cause of dispute between these three states. Now, the actual issue here is that the government of Karnataka had proposed to take waters from this Mandovi River to the Malaprabha River. If you see, this Malaprabha River is a tributary of Krishna River, which flows through Karnataka. So, the plan is to take the water from Mandovi River. And this involves building a project across Kalasa and Banduri. Both these are tributaries of this Mandovi River. So, the water from both these tributaries will be diverted to Malaprabha in order to meet the requirements of the nearby water scarce districts in northwestern Karnataka. But if you see, this proposal by the Karnataka government was opposed by the government of Goa. Following this, in the year 2010, the Mahadai Water Disputes Tribunal was formed by the central government. And if you see, the parties which are involved in this particular tribunal are the states of Goa, Karnataka and the state of Maharashtra. Now, though this tribunal has given some interim verdicts on water sharing, this particular issue is not yet been resolved completely by this tribunal. And few months back, if you see, the Union Minister of Environment, Forests and Climate Change had given environmental approval for this Kalasa Banduri project of Karnataka government. Now, according to this news article, the center has kept this order in abeyance, that is in temporary suspension. So, this project is temporarily suspended as of now. So, this is interim relief for the government of Goa, which is opposing this project. So we'll be getting more news articles on this particular issue in the future. We shall be discussing them in our future sessions. So to summarize this news article, we have seen about Mahadai River, then about the Mahadai Water Disputes Tribunal, and then about the Kalasa Banduri project. Now, one thing which you need to know here is Mahadai River flows only through two states, which is Karnataka and Goa, but the catchment area also includes Maharashtra, or we can tell the river basin also includes the state of Maharashtra. That's why Maharashtra is a party to this particular river dispute. So try to remember this difference. Now have a look at the practice question. Let us move on to the next news article. This news article is related to a recent judgment by the National Company Law Appellate Tribunal, in short NCLAT, in the Mistry versus Tata Sons case. NCLAT has ordered to restore Cyrus Mistry as the chairman of the Tata Sons. So in the context of this news article, we shall be discussing about NCLAT. Alongside, we shall also be discussing about National Company Law Tribunal. Then we'll be discussing the background of this issue and the related provisions in the Companies Act pertaining to this particular issue. The syllabus that is relevant to the analysis of this news article is given here for your reference. So first, let's understand the background of this issue. Know that Tata Sons Private Limited is the majority shareholder of the Tata Group of Companies. The other important shareholder is the Shapoorji Pallonji Group. In 2016, Cyrus Mistry, the then chairman of Tata Sons, was ousted from the post mainly because of the trust deficit between the majority shareholders and him. And at the same time, Tata Sons, which was a public firm, was converted into a private firm. And if you see, Cyrus Mistry's family had minority shares in Tata Group of Companies. So all these matters were taken to the National Company Law Tribunal by Cyrus Mistry family regarding these issues. But the National Company Law Tribunal dismissed the pleas of these companies. Hence, they approached the next appellate authority, which is the National Company Law Appellate Tribunal, that is NCLAT. Then if you see, NCLAT again directed NCLT to take up the pleas. But again, NCLT dismissed the pleas of the companies. Then again, the companies approached the NCLAT. And in the latest judgment, NCLAT has restored Cyrus Mistry as the chairman of Tata Sons. So this is the brief background of this issue. In its judgment, NCLAT has also said that the conversion of Tata Sons from public to private was illegal. So in today's analysis, we'll be discussing in detail about all the terms that we have just seen. First, let us understand NCLT and NCLAT. See, NCLT, that is the National Company Law Tribunal, is established based on Section 408 of the Companies Act of 2013. It is established for the adjudication of corporate civil disputes under two legislations. One is the Companies Act of 2013 and the next one is the Insolvency and Bankruptcy Code of 2016. If you see, this NCLT is a specialist body with both judicial and technical members. Now, note that if a party to the case is dissatisfied with the judgment given by NCLT, then the party can approach the appellate tribunal, which is the National Company Law Appellate Tribunal. And if you see, this NCLAT, or the National Company Law Appellate Tribunal, was constituted under Section 410 of the Companies Act of 2013. So you can see that both NCLT and NCLAT are statutory bodies. Now, the main function of this NCLAT is that to hear the appeals against the orders of NCLT. Apart from this, NCLAT has also one more function. It is also the appellate tribunal to hear and dispose appeals against any order on awarding compensation which is passed by the Competition Commission of India. So both these are the functions of NCLAT. Now, what if a party is not satisfied with the judgment of NCLAT? Then there is one more option for the party, which is to approach the Supreme Court. This is why the news article says that Tata Sons might move to the Supreme Court to challenge the order of NCLAT to reinstate Cyrus Mistry. So whenever you are reading such news articles, try to know the related statutory bodies and how it functions. For example, today we saw the background of NCLT to NCLAT to Supreme Court. And if you see, during the starting of our discussion, we also mentioned that the conversion of Tata Sons Limited from a public company to a private company by the Registrar of Companies was declared illegal by the judgment. So the judgment has asked the Registrar of Companies to record Tata Sons as a public company. So what is this Registrar of Companies? See, register of companies are appointed under Section 609 of the Companies Act. It covers various states and union territories. And if you see, they are vested with the primary duty of registering the companies that are floated in the respective states and the union territories. And they also ensure that such companies comply with the statutory requirements under this Companies Act. Now, note that in the year 2017, the Tata Sons received its shareholders' approval to convert itself into a private limited company from a public limited company. Now, why this public to private conversion takes place? Because you need to know that through the Companies Act of 2013, the compliances of the public companies are increasing day by day. So there are a lot of restrictions on doing business if they are a public limited company. But on the other hand, the private companies are exempted from various compliances from various provisions of this Companies Act of 2013. So because of this relaxation, many of the public companies have started converting into private companies. And one more thing to note here is that when a company becomes private limited, then it need not take shareholder consent in taking crucial decisions. So the crucial decisions can be passed just with the approval of the board of directors of that particular company. So in this case, you can see that the minority stakeholders are actually losing their say in the company's decision-making process. This is why NCLAT remarked that the decision to convert Tata Sons as private was prejudicial and oppressive to the minority shareholders, including the Shapoorji Pallonji Group. Because we saw that Shapoorji Pallonji Group was also a minority shareholder in Tata Sons. And if you see, along with this, the judgment given by NCLAT has also taken some other steps to ensure that the interests of the minority stakeholders are not affected. This judgment said that when the executive chairman, independent director and directors are appointed in the future, the majority group, which is the Tata Group, should consult the minority shareholders. Next, if you see, this NCLAT judgment also barred the Tata Sons from invoking its powers under Article 75 of the Articles of Association of Tata Sons. Now, here this Article 75 is not important, but you just try to know the definition of this Articles of Association. See, every company will have its own article of association. It is basically a document which specifies the regulations for a company's operations, and it is also a document which defines the company's purpose. And it will lay out the tasks that are to be accomplished within the organization, including the process of appointing directors and the handling of financial records. So this is all that you need to know what is meant by article of association. Now, you just know why this news article has discussed this Article 75, because this Article 75 of this company's Article of Association has empowered the majority stakeholders to force the minority shareholders to sell their shares. For example, a minority stakeholder can be forced to sell their shares, and hence they might stop to become the stakeholders or shareholders in the company. So, barring the power to invoke this article can also be seen as a measure to protect the interests of minority stakeholders in Tata Sons. Now, according to the news article, this judgment has put the Tata groups in uncertainty, because now it is difficult for the top management of Tata Sons to take any major decisions. So, the removal of Cyrus Mistry and the appointment of a new chairman has been held as illegal by the judgment. Now, this raises a question on what will happen to the decisions that have been taken by the new chairman once Cyrus Mistry was replaced. Now, soon after this judgment by NCLAT, the shares of Tata Group in the share market came down. It means that the investors who invest money in Tata Sons are now in an unclear position to whether invest or not in the future in Tata Sons because of this legal tussle. Because if you see, Tata Group of companies employs around 7 lakh people around the world, and it has an overall market value of approximately $150 billion. This is an evolving news article. We'll be getting more news on this particular issue. So let us discuss more on this news article in the future sessions as well. To summarize this news article, we have seen about the recent issue that has happened in Tata Sons. Along with this, we have seen about statutory bodies like the National Company Law Tribunal, then National Company Appellate Law Tribunal, and about the judgment given by NCLAT on this particular issue. Also, we saw some other provisions of the Companies Act in relation with this particular news. Now have a look at the practice question. Let us move on to the next news article. Now let us see this news article, which is related to a new technology which has been introduced in agriculture. The syllabus that is relevant to the analysis of this news article is given here for your reference. See, in this era of advanced technology, new equipments are developed and they are used in various sectors, and the technology helps to overcome the shortage of manpower in each case, because if you see, there is an immense shortage of manpower in the agricultural sector. So what is required at present is a single technology which can help in doing so many jobs at the same time, which even a single human being cannot do. So in this way, a technology which was used for other purposes is now used by the farmers of Andhra Pradesh to overcome the shortage of farm labor. This technology is nothing but the drone technology. See, drones are more formally known as unmanned aerial vehicles or unmanned aircraft systems. A drone is a flying robot which can be remotely controlled, or it can fly autonomously through software controlled flight plans in their embedded systems. Simply, we can tell it as remote controlled pilotless aircraft, as you can see in this representation. Now, these drones have been used for many purposes, like commercial aerial surveillance, then for commercial and motion picture filmmaking. Then it is also used in disaster relief, because if sensors are added to the drone, then it can be used to help locate the people and save the life when there is a natural disaster. And also, if you see, drones can be used to gather and deliver medical samples, medical supplies and medicines to the remote areas or unreachable areas in a disaster zone. So these are some of the areas where the drones are now being used. Now in this category, the drones are also used in agriculture by farmers. Now where they are actually applying this is to spray the pesticides in their agricultural fields in order to protect the crops from the pests. And if you see, the drone is doing the work in a short span of time. Now since the drone is carrying out the work which was used to be done by humans, now the farmers do not need the human labor, that is the farm laborers. So this technology also helps them financially, because they can save on the labor charges which are rising day by day. So the drone saves time, it saves the labor costs, and additionally it also saves the farmers from exposure to pesticides, because if farmers are spraying or using the pesticides, most of them spray it or use it by hand, since there is a lack of awareness overall if you see. Now this technology will prevent the farmers from getting exposed to pesticides. So health wise also the farmers will be benefited. Now since this technology has many positives, the farmers are suggesting that the government should promote this application of drone technology for agricultural purposes through Krishi Vigyan Kendras, so that the farmers across India will be able to access this technology at a subsidized costs. So let us take us this opportunity to know in detail about Krishi Vigyan Kendras. So what are these Krishi Vigyan Kendras? They are nothing but agricultural science centers. See, Krishi Vigyan Kendras were set up based on the recommendation by the Education Commission of 1964 to 1966. This commission is famously called as the Kothari Commission. Based on the recommendations of this commission, the Indian Council for Agricultural Research introduced the idea of establishing Krishi Vigyan Kendras or agricultural science centers. So these institutions impart vocational training to the practicing farmers and also to the school dropouts and also to the field level extension functionaries. And if you see, in the year 1973, this IKAR Standing Committee on Agricultural Education observed that Krishi Vigyan Kendras were of national importance, because they would help in accelerating the agricultural production, and it would also help in improving the socio-economic conditions of the farming community at that point of time. So based on this, the first Krishi Vigyan Kendra was established in the year 1974 at Puducherry on a pilot basis. At present, if you see, there are more than 650 Krishi Vigyan Kendras across India. This Krishi Vigyan Kendra scheme is 100% financed by the Government of India. The KVKs are sanctioned to agricultural universities, then to the IKAR institutes, then to the related government departments, and then to the non-government organizations which are working in the field of agriculture. Now also know that the Krishi Vigyan Kendras are an integral part of National Agricultural Research System, See, this aims at the assessment of location-specific technology modules in agriculture and allied enterprises. So this is done through technology assessment, then through refinement and through demonstrations. So the Krishi Vigyan Kendras have been functioning as knowledge and resource center of agricultural technology, and they also support various initiatives of the public sector, private sector and also the voluntary sector for improving the agricultural economy in India. So we can tell that the mandate of Krishi Vigyan Kendra is technology assessment and demonstration for its application and capacity development. Now let us see some of the unique features of these Krishi Vigyan Kendras. See, they create valuable resources in terms of technical manpower and assets, and they also help in the confirmation of technologies to suit the local specificity. That is, there are various agroclimate zones in India. So these Krishi Vigyan Kendras work on specific agroclimatic zones and they provide specific technologies to each and every zone. And also if you see, Krishi Vigyan Kendras come up with the new technologies which are called the frontier technologies, then Krishi Vigyan Kendras also help in capacity building among the stakeholders. And they lead in technology application, information and inputs. Then also if you see, the Krishi Vigyan Kendras carry out participatory approaches in planning, implementing, executing and evaluation. That is, it does not limit to the theoretical knowledge, but it ensures that the theory is applied practically and we get the output. Now, in addition to this, the Krishi Vigyan Kendras also produce quality technological products such as seeds, planting materials, bioagents, etc. And it makes them available to the farmers as well. And also if you see, the Krishi Vigyan Kendras identify and document selected farm innovations as well. So based on this only, the farmers in Andhra Pradesh are now suggesting to promote the usage of drone technology for spraying the pesticides in the farms, so that it will help the farmers across India. So this is the significance of Krishi Vigyan Kendras in India. So in this news article, we have seen about the usage of drones for agricultural purposes and the proposal by the farmers to promote this drone technology through Krishi Vigyan Kendras. So in this context, we also saw in detail about these Krishi Vigyan Kendras. Now have a look at the practice question. Let us move on to the practice questions discussion session. Now look at the first question. This question is about Krishi Vigyan Kendras. Four statements have been given and you need to choose the incorrect statements. Look at the first statement. It tells that KVK was set up based on the recommendation of Sarkaria Commission. This statement is wrong. KVK was set up based on the recommendation by the Education Commission of 1964 to 1966, which is famously known as Kothari Commission. It is not Sarkaria Commission. Look at the second statement. It tells that it was first established in Puducherry. This statement is correct. The first KVK was established in 1974 at Puducherry on a pilot basis. And if you see, it was established under the administrative control of the Tamil Nadu Agricultural University, which is located at Coimbatore in Tamil Nadu. So the second statement is correct. Now look at the third statement. It tells that it is financed on a 50-50 basis by union government and private companies working in agriculture. This statement is wrong because KVK scheme is 100% completely financed by the government of India. Now look at the fourth statement. It tells that its mandate is technology assessment and demonstration for its application and capacity development. Yes, this statement is correct. So the correct answer for this question is option D, 1 and 3 only, because this question asks you to choose the incorrect statements. Here statement 2 and 4 are correct and 1 and 3 are incorrect. Now look at the next question. Consider the following states. 5 states have been given: Tamil Nadu, Karnataka, Gujarat, Maharashtra and Goa. Which of the above states are parties to the Mahadai Water Disputes Tribunal? See, the Mahadai River, which is also called as Mandvi River, flows through 2 states, which are the states of Karnataka and Goa, but its catchment area is spread across 3 states, which are the states of Goa, Karnataka and Maharashtra. So only these 3 states are parties to the Mahadai Water Disputes Tribunal, which is formed in the year 2010. So here the correct answer is option D, 2, 4 and 5 only, Karnataka, Maharashtra and Goa. Now look at the next question. This question is about National Company Law Appellate Tribunal. 3 statements have been given and you need to choose the correct statements. Now look at the first statement. It tells that the National Company Law Appellate Tribunal is a constitutional body. This statement is wrong because it was constituted under Section 410 of the Companies Act of 2013. So we can see it has been established as per a statute or an act. So NCLAT is a statutory body, not a constitutional body. So the first statement goes wrong. Now, if you eliminate the first statement, you can arrive at the answer, which is option B, 2 and 3 only. But let us also look at the next two statements. The second statement, it tells that NCLAT is the appellate tribunal to hear and dispose appeals against any order on awarding compensation that has been passed by the Competition Commission of India. Yes, this is correct. Apart from this, NCLAT also hears appeals against the orders of the National Company Law Tribunal, which is also formed as per Section 408 of the Companies Act of 2013. So NCLT is also a statutory body. Now look at the third statement. It tells that the aggrieved party can appeal against the judgment of NCLAT in the Supreme Court. Yes, this statement is correct. If a person is not okay with the decision that has been delivered by the NCLAT, then the aggrieved party may appeal this decision in the Supreme Court. Now the recent news is that NCLAT has overturned the decision of NCLT and it has reinstated Cyrus Mistry as the chairman of Tata Sons. Now Tata Sons is planning to appeal this decision in the Supreme Court. So the correct answer for this question is option B, 2 and 3 only. Now look at this question. In the context of drones, which of the following tasks are accomplished by drones? Four tasks have been given. First is commercial aerial surveillance, then for carrying out disaster relief activities, then in agriculture for spraying pesticides, then motion picture filmmaking. So drones are used in all these activities. So the correct answer for this question is option D, all the above. Apart from this, drones are also used to gather and deliver medical samples, supplies and medicines to the remote areas or to the unreachable areas in a disaster zone. So the correct answer is option D here. Now look at the mains question. The question is, there is a need for laying down guidelines on the use of the Right to Information Act 2005 because the queries posed by people who had no locus standi in the matter regarding the queries. In the light of the above statement, discuss the problems related to providing reasons for requesting the information under the Act. So this quotation is the statement which has been made by the Chief Justice of India. As per RTI Act, no reason needs to be given by an applicant for filing an RTI petition. But the statement given by the Chief Justice of India contradicts the provisions that are given in the Act. So try to discuss all those problems that are related to providing reasons for requesting the information under the Act. Like what kind of challenges an applicant can face for seeking a particular information. Now please post your answers in the comment section. We shall review your answers and give suitable suggestions and recommendations for your answers. With this, we come to the end of the analysis of all the news articles taken up for today's discussion and also the practice questions discussion session. If you like the video, press the like button, comment and share, and do subscribe to Shankar IAS Academy YouTube channel for latest videos and updates. Stay focused and motivated, friends. Thank you.